can shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. So I can face my giants with confidence. Yeah. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. My giants with confidence.
Please pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for all who were able to come and worship together this morning. Lord, I pray over this service today that hearts would be open to receive your word. Lord, guide us through this service, through this day, and just help us to just give you glory for all that you have done. We praise you and we love you. Amen.
Good morning. Does anyone want to share what God's been doing in their lives?
I'm so glad to be here this morning. I praise God because God has been a true friend to me. All my life, you know, I had ups and downs. I've been in the mountain. I've been in the valley. But one thing I could say is a man that went to the cross and died for me, I should give all my blessing, you know, all towards him, that he gave me every blessing he could towards me. And sometimes you don't know what to say, but there's one thing you can say is Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is my friend. Jesus Christ died for me. Jesus Christ is the only one that gave me anything. This world didn't give me nothing, but Jesus Christ gave everything that I need to survive in this world today. And knowing this ain't thy world, that I'm just a pilgrim here. And my pilgrimage is here, you know, until I die. And, you know, or the rapture comes first. And that's all I live for. I live for Jesus. I don't live for anything else because this ain't our world. You know, we may be in this awful world we live in today, but we got to make the best of it through Jesus Christ. Thank you.
I just have a praise. My son had a mini stroke on Wednesday. They rushed him down to Presby, but he's all right. They got there in time, and he has to wear a heart monitor for like a month, but they didn't find any blood clots or anything, so I praise God. Amen.
Not everybody had heard, but many have asked me about Genevieve and her being by herself. And the reason why she's kind of by herself now is Terry had a stroke. I don't know if everybody knew that Terry Murdoch had a stroke, but praise God. I was down yesterday at the Allegheny General, and she's doing very well. Keep praying because her speech is impaired a little bit, but I'm just believing God that everything will be good. But for those of you who would, Genevieve is, She's going to kind of be by herself, but she does, Terry was really concerned, but she said, you know, she does good for breakfast and lunch, but if we could kind of get together and see that she has something to eat on for the dinner meal. So we're going to have to try to get a little sign-up sheet going or something and figure that out. And I know that we need to see people stop in and seeing Genevieve, but that was Terry's concern, even with her being so, what was going on with her and her life, and she was concerned about Genevieve. So what a blessing Terry is to each one of us, and just continue to pray, and I believe that she's on the road to recovery, and God has really undertaken in that situation. So thank you for all your continued prayers on behalf of Terry.
I want to add to that some. Terry is just an amazing person. If you don't know her, she has the biggest heart. She goes or tries to go weekly to see Todd's grandfather and visit him. She's just been such a blessing to us. She has a serving heart. If you just talk to her and the things that she does for people, she's just amazing. So it broke my heart to hear that she was going through this. So if you could continue to pray for her and just get to know her. She does build you up. She prays for everyone. I can't express how blessed I am to have her as a friend. Today I just thank God so much for days like this. I struggled all weekend. I had some pretty bad pain all weekend. I know what I did. For me, I can take one bite of something that I shouldn't have, and I suffer. And I know that, and I continue to do it. It's so hard when you're so restricted to not want something else. I was great. I felt great for a week. And when I feel good, I feel so good. I feel so healthy. And then I think, oh, I can do anything. I can have whatever I want. So I take that risk and I eat a bite of something and then I pay severely for it. So I was in pretty bad pain all weekend. But today is, I did a 180. I feel so amazing. And I just thank God for these days.
Anyone else?
Good morning, Grace. Just having concern for my son, Matthew. Matthew had blood work done at the beginning of the month to check his ammonia level. And it was elevated. It was 78. They don't like it to be any higher than 47. So the doctor, we repeated it 2 weeks later. Before we did the blood work, I reached out to family and friends and asked for prayers for Matthew. And praise the Lord, his level dropped. We're still elevated, but we went from 78 to 57. They want it to be at 47. So I just thank everybody that prayed for Matt. Continue to pray that we get to where we need to be. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Okay. Yeah, buckle up. She said it's my turn to sing, which nobody wants. So, all right. Least of all me, actually. It's all right. Well, good morning. We had some birthdays and anniversaries. Let's go ahead and celebrate some of those. So Rob and Audrey's anniversary is this week, right? That's why they're not here. They're actually away on their anniversary somewhere. Not here. So they're, Rob told me where they were going, and I wasn't paying attention. So they went away, and good for them. They're good about that. So wish them a happy anniversary when you see them. Next week they should be around, hopefully. So all right, we do have some birthdays coming up though. So Glenn, happy birthday to you. Why don't you come on up? Also, River's birthday's on Monday, and Rhonda has a birthday this weekend. Sam Kale. So I know I see Terry. There she is. Okay. Come on up. Also, we're going to be praying over Matt this morning. So how you doing? Wanda, are we praying for Matt? Yep. All right. So Matt's going to come up. We're going to anoint Matt and pray over him as well for his upcoming blood work that's being done, and just praying those levels continue to decrease. So get him up here as well. And if you wouldn't mind coming on up and praying over these folks. I know we do it every week for their birthday, but if you would, please consider coming up and praying for Matthew. Even if you don't normally do that, it would be such an encouragement to the family. So I'll give you a couple minutes if you want to come on up, seconds, I guess, to make it up here and get in the crowd and pray over this young man. All right. Well, would you guys join us in a word of prayer? Our Father, we are so thankful for you and the way that you care for us and the way that you are such a blessing to us. And Father, I thank you for, once again, the folks that you bring into our lives, that we do not believe that the people that are in our lives are here by accident. And many times we wanted our life to go in a different direction. And then we get into the place where I believe you led us, and we meet people and we realize, I needed them. And Lord, I am surrounded right now by people that I needed and that I didn't realize I needed in my life. And so I'm so thankful for these people that you've brought our way, and I pray that we not miss the fact that that you orchestrated this from the beginning of their lives, that you were working them and us together. And I pray and thank you very much this morning for Glenn. I pray you'd keep him safe at work, that you would give him great success as a father and as a grandfather, and as he leads his family as the patriarch, that he'd be able to lead them in wisdom and grace and kindness and understanding, that they would most of all know you as their Savior through Glenn's influence, and that his kids and his grandkids would see that relationship he has with you. Not that it'd be flashy or anything over the top extravagant, but that he just has a faithful relationship with God, and that his young ones would want that. And Lord, I thank you for the influence he already has in that regard, as you see Cal coming. We're just so thankful for that. I also want to ask that you give him the best year of his life, that he could look back on this year and say, this was a mountaintop year for me. Not because things were all good and everything went his way, but because he grew in his relationship with you through the course of this year in a way that he hasn't before. And we ask for that that growth and that advancement in his heart and his life, that he would know his Savior. And he'd know, as Job said, that my Redeemer lives, and that he could hold on to that truth. I also want to lift up the same thing for River, young man out in the middle of liberal country out there in Washington, and we do pray for his heart and his soul as he does his work, that you would protect him from the predations of society and culture, that he would be able to chase down all the things that you have for him to chase down, that he'd be the influence in the workspace that he is, but most of all, Lord, that you would continue to draw him back to yourself as he prepares young men for the eventuality or the likelihood that they may one day find themselves in hostile in hostile hands, that, Lord, they would be well prepared and they would be able to lean on the training that River gives them, that they would have strength and endurance there. And give him that in his work. Give him the best year of his life in everything he pursues. Let it be wise, let it be strong, let it be capable. And continue to build River up into the young man that you have designed for River to be. And I also want to lift up to you, Rhonda, another person, Lord, that you have created well and in my opinion, broke the mold when you created her. And we're so thankful for Rhonda, for the way that she sees things from angles that no one else sees and is able to prepare for things that none of us would have been prepared for. But we are sure are glad that we were prepared because they happen. And so I thank you so much for Rhonda and the way that she is able to lead our young ones and the relationship she has with them and the way that she is able to open our eyes to what you are doing around us in, Lord, ways that we wouldn't normally see. Lord, I pray that you'd give her great success in her work, give her great success in her marriage and in being a mother and a grandmother, that she would be able to lead and guide with gladness and joy and raise up a generation that is capable of taking on the advancement of Satan and beat him back to where he belongs. I just ask this in humility, knowing, Lord, that it isn't her heart to be recognized, but it is her heart to be wise and right. And Lord, that's such a good heart to have. So I pray that you would take that humble heart and give it the best year of his life as she continues on in all the things that she does. Praying the same thing over Sam as she works and lives and she puts her education to use, that she would be able to influence the world for you, that she'd be able to move, see what's going on in the world, write down what's going on, and be able to open people's eyes to the reality that there is a higher purpose and greater things going on than just the circumstances on the ground. I pray that you would continue to give her influence in her workplace, continue to give her peace and fulfillment in all the things that she does, and Lord, give her once again the best year of her life, that she can look backwards and see your blessings over and over and over again. And I also want to lift up our brother Matthew to you as he goes in for some testing, and we just ask that you would continue to build the young man up, continue to make him wise and strong and capable, that you would continue to bring those ammonia levels down in his blood work so that he is able to stave off and avoid many of the issues that will come along with having elevated levels going on in his life, that this chemical compound within his body, Lord, you are capable, we know, of speaking into his body and telling those things to disperse. So I just ask that you would, and we believe that you will, that his next test, his doctors will be amazed, And that Wanda will be able to say, this is because we have prayed and because you, our Lord, have taken those things away. And give that testimony and draw even the most staunch critic to a place where they have to look upon you. And Lord Jesus, we are so thankful for Matthew. Continue to bless him in his body and bring him healing. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, so our little ones are free to head to their classroom. I got a little too much in my microphone, just a little bit. Can you bring me down? All right. Are you now? Is it you now? You're up now?
Yeah. My guitar. Good morning, everybody. I'm going to play you guys a song. It's called Known by Taryn Wells. I hope you like it.
Got your Bible with you, go ahead and open up book of Genesis chapter 11 is where we'll start. Actually, we'll start in Philippians chapter 2, so if you want to keep your finger in Genesis and go to Philippians, you might want to do that. All right, so I meet with a group of pastors. Every week we get together 9:30 Wednesday mornings and meet together for prayer. That's kind of what we do. Just about eight of us in the area that do that together. In the midst of which, I think you can look at life as a tragedy or as a comedy, and I choose comedy. So, anyone else just kind of chuckle during the House Speaker fight that the Republican Party had? Did anyone else laugh about that. Anyway, I did. So I thought it was funny, and one of the other guys did not. So he was like, what's the deal? Why is there so much division? Now, as a guy who's into that sort of thing and a nerd about it, I was like, I need you to understand that the government being divided is not a bug, it's a feature, and that's how it's made, and you want them divided. So, like, there's Republican and there's Democrat, conservative, liberal, and then even within things you got stuff. So there's like the classical liberal, then there's far left, and people get all wound up about that. And then there's your you know, more conservative folks, and there's the far right, and people get all fired up about that. And then there's different caucuses and committees and all kinds of things going on. But the reality is that our elected representatives have learned, and here's just something kind of awful about the whole system, is that they have learned that being elected to high office is really good for your personal brand, and you can sell yourself then to other things because you were elected to office. So that's no good. So in fact, what we don't have is a division of two camps. We actually have 100 people in the Senate that are all looking out for themselves, and then we've got 435 folks in the House, I think, that are looking out for themselves. So we got 535 different divisions going on in this thing because people are trying to get the 5-second soundbite to get reelected or to get hired as a lobbyist or something like that. So anyway, this is actually what's going on. We have more division than just two parties. But the silver lining here is the more they fight with each other, the less they fight with us, right? You know, like, so, and that's how it's made, right? It's built so that they disagree with one another and leave us alone. Like, that's really kind of how the system was built, by the genius and really under the inspiration of God, the system devised by our founding fathers, who knew enough to say, if we can just get them to where there's checks on power. Because what I said to my friend was, you don't want a unified government. A unified government is capable of a whole lot of evil. Let's talk through some unified governments. North Korea. They're pretty unified, right? Communist China, they get along, right? At least on paper. Then, you know, what about Saudi Arabia, Russia, Nazi Germany? They were unified, right? Unified government is capable of a lot of evil. And so the reality is that when we have a unified government, it's dangerous, and our founders knew better, and they made a divided government. So they leave us alone. Right, and there's a lot of evil that can be produced through unity, especially in the human heart, because if you remember from last week, the human heart is bent towards only evil continually, right? And that's what God realized, and that's why he sent a flood. So he knew how the human heart was designed, and he knew that if we were able to unify together around that evil, what would happen is abuse. And we, you know, from which comes the old saying, right? Absolute power corrupts absolutely, right? And we see that on display often. We don't want unity matched with unbridled authority. You end up getting abuse. And you know, if you want to go from biblical references, look at Egypt, the abuse that happened because they had one tyrant in rule. That in Babylon's the same way. Look at the order of the Pharisees, who found themselves, like, as you read through the Gospels and you see them positioned against God himself as walking in the flesh and positioned against the people, how many times do they say, like, we really want to kill this Jesus guy, but the people will be mad? And so they found themselves positioned against God and the people, right? And they were constantly in that battle, but they were putting rules and laws and regulations upon the people that the people couldn't shoulder, and it was too much. The Pharisees were unified in the way that they led. And you had Rome, consolidated power and authority, and a unified people is not healthy, right? Because we as humans need someone that says no, and has the power to hold that, right? Have you ever, like, walked through the grocery store and you saw someone whose child has never heard the word no? And you want to personally go up there and spank them, right? And you're like, I can get away with it. You ever, like, think that? You're like, I could get in there and out real quick, just whoop that kid, right? Because, like, you need no. You need to hear the word no. It needs to happen to you often. We need checked. If we are the king and the God of our own hearts, it will lead to us being evil and abusive. So that brings us to the Tower of Babel, a place where we see God divide the people. If you ever hear the question, when did we become so divided? Bring them to Genesis 11 and say, this is where God divided the people because we needed the boundaries and the checks, right? We needed to hear no. We needed those guardrails put up in our lives. But first, we're going to go to the book of Philippians. Philippians, because I want to show you what it looks like when we are unified around the right things. So, like, because we can be unified around evil, we can be unified around power, we can be unified around authority, we can be unified around our own desires, but that will only lead to abuse, and what we are to be unified around is actually the person of Christ, and what it looks like when we're unified around the person of Christ. So, Paul said this in the book of Philippians, chapter 2. Verse 1, so if there's any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Listen to this. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each one of you look not only to his own interests, but also the interests of others. Does anyone want to sit Congress down and read this to them? Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant, being made in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under heaven, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is what we unify around. When we unify around the person of Christ and we submit to him and we humble ourselves and we put other people first, that what we find is a unity that brings life and doesn't bring destruction. Right, that what we find is a unity that works, a unity that isn't going to be abusive and oppressive. And so we don't, like in the person of Christ, we don't need to build towers to reach God. He's the tower by which we reach God. We don't need to work our way there through somehow through being able to earn our way to God. Jesus paid it all, right? And we don't need to be perfect because he has become our perfection, and we can lean upon that and reach levels of righteousness that we just can't get to on our own. This is what we unify around, and we submit to the authority of Jesus Christ instead of becoming a law unto ourselves. And this is a huge issue in the world today. We have a lot of people who have no one that they're submitting to. Like, we need to submit to somebody, right? Whether that be your parents, whether that be your spouse, like, you need to find a person that you can submit. Like, even if that is if you have no one and you just go find someone who's older and wiser than you and you say, listen, I need someone to submit to, it's going to be you, so I'm going to come to you for advice, and when I ask for advice, I'm going to listen to what you say, right? Like, and that's the way you do it, because we need someone to check our intentions and check our motives and submit to somebody. Ideally, we submit to the Lord, but we have a lot of people who aren't submitted to the Lord. They aren't submitted to each other, aren't even submitted to their spouse. Like, you know, we call ourselves the master of our homes, but we're called in Scripture to mutual submission. That I submit to you, you submit to me, and we look for your needs ahead of our own. We look at your wants ahead of our own. And when we don't have any authority over us, we have made a recipe for disaster. We need an authority over us, someone that will call us back to the Lord. And the reality is that the Lord will humble you. Right? Now, you can humble yourself, and that's much more pain-free than when God has to do it. Anyone here ever been humbled by the Lord? Hurt's done it, right? So what we are called to do is replace our mind with the mind of Christ. And in this way, we will find ourselves in glad submission to the will of God, glad submission to the authority of God, and you'll find yourself, you'll find levels of fulfillment and satisfaction and joy and peace and contentment that you never knew could exist. Like, right, he calls us to life in abundance. And the life that we're trying to build for ourselves, like, if we build it, we'll be so worried that it'll fall apart that we can't enjoy it, right? And we'll never find the joy in life in abundance when we're trying to build it ourselves. In fact, life in abundance is gained by those who give up their life to take on the life of Jesus. Matthew chapter 10 put it this way, whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. That if I give up my hopes and my dreams and my intentions and all the things I want, that I will, and find life in Christ, then I will find what I was truly looking for. This is not the life of a tower builder. This is the life of those who have abandoned his life to gain the life of Christ. And, you know, you think, like, this is all through Scripture. That this idea of building your life in the right way, like, you know, that even in the Gospels, Jesus told a parable of the guy who builds his life on the rock, and then there's a guy who builds his life on the sand, and the guy who built his life on the sand, his life fell apart, and the guy who built it on a rock, it stood the test of time. One is unwise, one is wise. One is building your life on your own abilities and your own skills, and one is building your life on the person of Jesus Christ. One has a lot of effort with no reward, and one has submission with eternal reward. And this is where brings us to the book of Genesis chapter 11, where we'll pick it up at the Tower of Babel. Now, the name Babel here, they didn't name the tower that, because that'd be ridiculous. God named the city that after this event, or people named the city that after this event, because of the languages being dispersed. So it was a tower in a city that is now known as Babel. And it's still, they think they're finding remnants, but they haven't really found remnants yet that they can conclusively say. But we do see throughout history different writers that pointed back to this, and we can see things that that this was pretty well agreed upon a real event. We know it is because the Bible says it is, but you know, the rest of the world is always slow to catch up. So, Genesis 11, we'll pick it up in verse 1. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as the people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks, burn them thoroughly. And they had bricks for stone and bitumen for mortar. Now, so they're speaking the same language, or at least a very similar language, most likely to the one that was given to Adam. You know, so now I don't know how God did that, if he just created Adam and Adam knew all the words, or if he taught Adam to speak during their times together. I don't know how that worked out, but most likely this is a language that came down that Adam had imparted onto his children and grandchildren and all the way down through all of his descendants, and he taught them to speak it, which makes us believe that most likely it was a far better language than the one we speak. In your daily life, do you ever encounter a situation where you wish you knew English better? Right, like, I do. I'm like, man, I wish. I probably, like, the third most used website for me is a thesaurus. Because I'm like, how else can I say this? You know, and I try and learn new words. So, like, we do find the English language is lacking, and there's a reason to that. It's because over time and through human use, it's just been degraded, right? We have lost some. Like, have you ever read something from decades ago, and you're like, okay, we are not as smart as those people. Amy was telling me just about this the other day, that she was reading a kid's book to our kids that her dad gave, that was his, and she's like, the words it's using are way more advanced than the ones in our kids' books today. You know, and the reality was is because we were better at it. You know, every time I hear kids use new slang, I'm like, stop that. Those aren't words. And so, we'll go out and do stuff with the youth, and like a kid, this happened once. He's like, listen, no cap, and he starts talking, and I'm like, hold up. Like, I don't see where a hat fits into the story. And he's like, no, cap means lie. I was like, listen, okay, first of all, cap is three letters and so is lie, so you saved no time, and there's no purpose in changing language here. Like, that's not a word. Don't use fake words, right? And expect me to just understand what that means. You know, and so anyway, like, this is just like the world we live in, they start to make things up and then expect us to catch up. It's annoying. Anyway, so that's not in my notes. That's just something I'm annoyed by. but this is most likely a language spoken that the Lord had imparted on to Adam, and therefore, like the rest of his creation, would have been good and complete. And now we find ourselves speaking language that lacks because we've degraded it over time, and we are missing things. But the first place you see this splinter is in language, because that's where they came together around, was language. And we'll see that the world was divided by God's sovereign design. That God knew it would be better to divide the world and then have the world come back together around his son than to keep it as one people. So as the people were migrating westward, they found a place that they believed they could settle and create a civilization that just couldn't be rivaled. So that was their plan. They had these great intentions, and they paired it with horrible execution. So, and isn't that us, right? You know, we have these good intentions, and then we, you know, so they wanted to create a great civilization. They wanted to be great. They wanted to be unrivaled. They wanted to be safe. And they tried to do this all under their own understanding. And they wanted to reach God, which is a really good goal. They want to be in the presence of God, which sounds like a good goal, when in reality the intention of the heart was evil. And not, I want to know God, but it was something else. And we'll get into that in a minute. And then they try and build that with mud bricks and tar mortar. I just don't see that going well. Right? Like, anyone here in the building trades, if you're trying to build a tower tall enough to reach God and you make it out of mud, at some point it falls down under its own weight. Right? Like, the materials in which they're using, they weren't materials because they're best for the work. They're materials because it's what they had at the time. This is what we've got. Let's use it. Right? And there's no way they could have ever achieved what they wanted to achieve with what they were using. All of it would have been washed away, and in fact, all of it is. There's no remnants of the Tower of Babel. So the materials they're using are not suitable for the work that they desire to do. You know, like, listen, secular folks, people who don't believe in God, teach this to their children, right? So there's three pigs, and there's a wolf with, like, a solid set of lungs, right? And the one pig builds a house out of straw. You know what I'm talking about? And what's the wolf come? He huffs and puffs, and he blows it down and eats the pig, right? Didn't turn out so good for him. So there's a second pig. He built his house out of sticks because he's smart. And so, like, the wolf comes, and he blows the house down and eats the pig. And then it comes a third one. He can't blow the house down, right? The pig talks a whole lot of smack. And, like, you know, you've read the story, right? Like, so this is where I could go into the whole story, because I've read it a lot to my children. But the idea there is that when we're building our life with the things that we can handle, with the stuff that we're capable of doing, and we're not building it out of the solid rock of Jesus Christ, then what we have done is we've built a house that won't be able to stand. Even if God didn't intervene, it wouldn't be able to stand. It would eventually fall under its own weight. It would fall either to the elements of this world or it would fall when the wolves come and devour us. But one way or another, we would fall. Because we built our life on the wrong foundation. We've built it out of the wrong materials. And we aren't going to be able to stand the test of time. But these people, undeterred, continue in their foolishness. So look at verse 4, Genesis 11, verse 4. And then they said, come, let us build. And look at the arrogance here. Then they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower that the children of man had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do, and nothing they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Like, you just, the arrogance jumps off the page, doesn't it? Like, let us build a city. Let us be great. Let us make a name for ourselves. Let us, you know, reach the Lord. And really, like, it's arrogant not because they think they're going to be amazing, but because they say we can, by our own efforts, reach the heights upon which God himself stands. And they are seeking to make a name for themselves, which they did, right? Like, we're talking about them today. Not because of their success. We're talking about them today because they failed, right? They didn't want to be nobody. They wanted greatness. And instead of letting God exalt them, they decided to exalt themselves. But it goes beyond simple self-exaltation. They wanted to stand where God stands. They wanted to reach the heights upon which he is. And it's a testament to the rebelliousness of the heart of man. And so God comes down, he walks among them, and they didn't notice, which I think is hilarious, right? Like, how often that happened in the Bible? God showed up, and they're like, who's this nerd? You know, and they just, like, ignored the person. You know, like, how often that happened throughout Scripture? So they come down, and God comes down. They don't notice he's there, and he observes that what they are doing and what they are working towards. And he sees that, and I don't want you to see it say that they're going to reach God. Like, don't see it say that if I let them go, they're going to get to me. They're actually going to achieve what they're seeking. What he is pointing out is that their hearts are bent towards only evil continually, and they will find greater and greater depths to their evil, and they will reach it. Right? That if we don't intervene, they will reach the evils that they desire to reach. Like, and even if their intentions were good, their actions aren't going to get, like, have you been there where you wanted something and then how you behaved to get to that place didn't line up, right? Like, and what you say you wanted and what you did aren't ever going to meet, you know what I'm saying? Like, okay, here's an example. Like, ladies, you get upset that you're not having meaningful conversation with your husband, so you stop talking to him. Like, that's not going to get you where you want to be, you know? Like, you want meaningful conversation. I'm not talking to you anymore, right? And your husband's out fishing, having the best day, right? Or, like, men, you're not off the hook. Like, you're, like, tired of your wife nagging at you, and yet you do the things that she nags you about, right? And you just keep doing them. Like this is the problem. What you want and what you do have to line up if you want them to come together, right? We just want to be in the presence of God. Then all they had to do was submit to the authority of God, and he would be among them, right? They didn't need to build a tower. They just needed to submit to the Lord. And they wanted to be great like the Lord. They wanted a name for themselves. They wanted that recognition and that glory. And that's what they were working towards. And what they ended up working towards, not realizing it, was their own destruction. Like, what we're going to achieve here is our own destruction. They just didn't realize it. So they put the work in, thinking they were going to be great, actually working towards their own demise. But if they truly wanted to find their life, they needed to lose it in Christ. Surrender to the Lord and live, defy him and perish. And they chose defiance. And we see this as a word from God, that they will actually, listen, they're going to achieve what they're set out for. They set out to achieve destruction, they're going to get there, right? Because remember, their hearts are bent towards evil, and in the context of that, this moment, that they will accomplish that evil. Like the governments we mentioned before, that unity led to oppression. So, and I'll show you that in a minute. Verse 7, let's keep rolling. Come, let us go down there and confuse their language, so they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord dispersed them over the face of the earth. So it's actually God himself who creates this division. And he created it as a safeguard, as a barrier. He created it as guardrails to help them live a healthy and fulfilled life, to lead them back to his goodness and mercy. Because he knew if they continued down the road they were going, that they would continue to turn to evil, as they had before the flood and as they were continuing to do now. And like, just for a minute, imagine what it would read like if he let them build the tower and it collapsed. Here's what they would have said, right? Where was God in all of this? Right? Isn't that what we do when our towers collapse? Right? Listen, every single time there's a school shooting, where's God in all of this? You mean, where's God in the place that you told him not to come? Right? And in among a society in which you have said there is no sanctity of human life, where's God in it? How could a loving God let this happen? You hear that too. He confused their language so that they would come back to his goodness and his mercy. He created a barrier for their good. Now, there's another reason they were building this tower, and I think this one's overlooked. You can tell me, maybe I overlooked it, and I'm the only one who overlooked it, but there's another reason that they were building this, and it's actually to escape from the consequences of their own sin. Because you remember, they're coming off of the flood. That's fresh in their minds. This is the person who built this is a fellow by the name of Nimrod, which is an insult today, and for good reason. But he's Noah's great-grandson. So, I mean, we're just a couple generations removed here. And so what we see is in this, you know, just a couple generations down the line is Noah's great-grandson Nimrod building this tower to man's rebellion. There's a historian by the name of Josephus who wrote a lot of Jewish history. His book I'm going to quote from is called The Antiquity of the Jews, and it was written give or take 10 or 20 years after Jesus, right? So, I mean, you're just a decade away from Jesus' life when this guy wrote these things down, and he said this about Nimrod. He also gradually changed the government into tyranny, seeing no other way of turning men from the fear of God but to bring them into a constant dependence upon his power. He also said he would be revenged on God if he should have a mind to drown the world again, for that he would build a tower too high for the waters to be able to reach, and that he would avenge himself on God for destroying their forefathers. And that's from his book, Antiquities of the Jews, Book 1, Part 4. So, the idea is, I want to continue on sinning, and I'll build a tower so big so that if God has to bring consequences upon me for my sin, I can get up in there and be safe. Right? Don't we live in a world that seeks to remove itself from any responsibility for its sin? Don't we? This isn't just an innocent, if I work at it, I can reach God. He is actively trying to protect himself from the consequences of his own sin. because they're coming off the flood where there was consequences for sin, right? And they were building a tower so that as their sin increased and so that if God had to destroy the earth and if he chose to do it by flood again, which means they didn't trust him because he said he wouldn't, right? Like, the one thing you shouldn't be buying right now is flood insurance, right? Like, that was his thing, you know, but he bought flood insurance by building a tower that he believed could be tall enough that he could survive if God had to flood the world again. He wanted to protect himself from the consequences of sin. Not stop sinning, just be able to do it without paying the price for it. We see that today, right? If we, you know, the world we inhabit, I want to get an education, but I don't want to pay for it, right? Yeah, me too, right? We want to have casual sex, but I don't want to be responsible for what happens if I do. So if I get a disease, well, I want medication for that, right? And if I end up having a child, I feel like I should be able to murder that child so I don't have to bear the consequences of what I did. It's a sick society that seeks to remove its people from any semblance of responsibility. But that's what Nimrod was trying to do. And every Nimrod in power that tries to do it today, right, is seeking to remove you from the consequences of your action. And given enough time, I think Babel would have gotten themselves there. And I think America's just about there, where we have almost effectively removed everyone from the consequences of our actions. We haven't removed everyone from the consequences of our actions. We've removed ourselves, and our kids are going to pay for that. Like, let's just be real. But what Jesus offers is not a life free from responsibility, but in fact, what he offers us the strength to overcome desires and temptations, and he also offers us the strength to walk through the consequences of our actions, to learn from what we've done, and to follow after him. That's what he's offered us. He's offered us forgiveness and mercy and strength to persevere as we walk through the consequences of our actions. And it goes back to the book of Philippians chapter 2 where he said, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not account equality with God as a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." Lord, we thank you for the chance to come to you. I thank you that you have offered grace and forgiveness and mercy. I thank you, Lord, that you have not stopped the consequences of our sin, but Lord, that you walk through those things with us. You give us strength to endure. You teach us along the way so that we may avoid those faults and failures in the future. I ask that you would that you would continue to humble us, that we would continue to put ourselves last so we may exalt the world around us. And Lord, let us not seek to make a name for ourselves, but Lord, let us be true worshipers seeking to make your name great in the world around us. We love you, Jesus. I pray that when you walk among us, we see it. I pray that when the consequences of our sin crash against us, that we haven't built towers to protect ourselves from it. And Lord, most of all, I pray that we would see our sin and that we would walk in your paths and not chase down the things that we desire. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for all you do for us. In your name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing?
Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Great job, everyone. Let's continue our worship with the doxology. It's something we do week in, week out. It's just something that it's a good reminder for us to remember where our blessings are housed and where they come from. And I think it's also good for us to look at the fact of how undeserving we are for the things we've been blessed with, and yet we get them without Him holding back. So let's just give Him some praise for that.
Praise him, all creatures, here we go. Praise him, all of me, here we go.
Lord Jesus, once again, we're beyond blessed by you. I just thank you for all the things that you bring our way, the people, the material blessings, our safety, our freedoms. We are beyond blessed by you with all the things that we enjoy, and I thank you for all of it. I pray that we would be a people who not seek to only build our own lives, but most of all that we would not be seeking to build our lives in defiance of you. That we would, when we are encountering things or we have desires or feelings that are outside of your prescriptions for us, that we would leave those things behind and take hold of what you desire. Or make us a people that give up our life to take yours. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. I have a seat for me real quick. Couple announcements for you. I think there's a video, if I'm not mistaken. Is that now?
Fuzzy command to internal.
Engines off. Opening main door.
So that's our VBS this year, is stellar. So we are we're starting now to get plans made for here in June. It's just a few months away, so don't be shocked when you're like, VBS already? Yeah, it's just a few months out. So and it's already almost the end of February, right? Like this year is kind of moving quick. Janelle has a sign up for volunteers. We also have a group. A friend of mine is a youth pastor in Michigan. He's bringing 20-some students down to help take much of the kind of burden off of you so that your responsibility will be to love on and engage with these kids that God's going to bless us with. I don't know how many we had, 118 last year, something like that came out. And it's just been growing quite a bit every year due to the hard work of Janelle, but also the blessings of God. So we're hoping that he continues to bless, and we're opening the door this year to Leatherwood's going to join us again and bring their crew up, as well as some other churches in town that don't do VBSs. We've been talking with them, and they're like, actually, we'd like to promote yours as the one that people should take their kids to. So we have a lot more traction this year, but also something we see, and if you could be praying about, is kids from the community that don't have a church home, that don't really have a faith background in the home, are coming out to VBS year in, year out, and they look forward to it. So we are excited to bring them back and have them come back, but also give you the freedom not to feel like you have the burden of preparing everything for VBS, then doing VBS, and then clean up and all that stuff. We have a crew coming to do that. So that's the plan, and they'll help you as you execute, and it's just going to be a big help for you. So if you're worried about being able to signing up and having all the work that comes with it, don't. It's not going to be like that. So, all right. Next week is our teacher appreciation lunch. So stick around if you have like I said last week, if you had to drag someone out in the parking lot and teach them a lesson, like, we want you to stick around. You taught someone something. So, like, come, stick around. We want you to, do you want me to finish or do you want to go? Okay. So, Shay had her hand up and I didn't know what to do with it. So Zach's is catering again. We are having our teacher appreciation lunch for those that teach here, whether it be adults, children, your nursery, you're in that group. So this is just something that we know a lot of work goes into preparing lessons and all that stuff and giving of your time. So we wanted to say thank you and give back to you. Shay, go ahead.
Make sure you sign up today, please.
Downstairs, I think. Perfect. And our men's fellowship is kicking off here next month, about a month from now, 3:14. So men, be coming out. It will be every other Tuesday, I believe, at 7. So we're kind of starting it. We're starting it then. And Tim is going to be. Is Tim in the room? He's teaching. Okay. So Tim will be heading that up, and we're really looking forward to it. Also, our church membership class, we do it twice a year. So if you're new to Grace or you just haven't worked through one yet, we just work through how the church is governed, what our statement of faith and what we believe here, and kind of walk through some of the things of how Grace does what Grace does. And so that's March 19th after church on Sunday. Lunch and child care is provided from about 11 to 2, somewhere in that ballpark. And if you want to be a part of that, let me know, and we'll get all the paperwork and everything ready for you, the church constitution, all that stuff. So, and then in about a month, we'll keep you apprised of this. It's a busy March, it looks like. But we have an event coming up called OT Live. You'll see some signs posted around the building for it. But Clarion area churches have come together to put this on, and it is a walk through the Old Testament. So it's just a couple of hours. They suggest for about third grade and up, if you're wanting to bring kids, so kind of try and be in that ballpark, unless they're really into motions and rhymes and things like that. But they will walk you through the Old Testament and give you the chronological story of the Old Testament in a way that you can remember it, so you know where things are. And it just kind of helps put all that stuff together. From 9 to noon, it's a good event. So plan on being there for that. It's $20 per person, $40 for a family. So if you want to come and bring two kids with you, you can. It's just $40. Don't feel like you have to pay the whole amount. And then, of course, Financial Peace University will also be starting in the month of March. I can't remember the date we decided on that. It's in March. So come on out for that. If you want to go through that, we need to know that. So there's a sign up for that as well. We'll be ordering materials soon. And if you want to walk that road with us in March, Nate and Nikki will be leading out. Nate for sure. And maybe Nikki. And so we'll be heading that up. And if you want to know the value of it, talk to the APOs or the Archies, and they will they'll walk you through the freedom it does actually bring. So anything else? Is that it? Oh, yeah. And then mark your calendar for this. April 2nd, we're renting the pool at the YMCA and having kind of a get-together there. But we're also holding a baptism service at the same time. So if you've never been baptized, or if you were as a baby and you want to now as an adult, or, you know, you just want to be baptized, I'm not going to put a restriction on you. You want to be baptized? Come on.
That's 4:00.
The time is 4:00? Okay, so we get the pool at 4:00. It's ours, and you know, we'll have food and all that stuff. So come on out. It'll be a good time. All right, Tina. And you get a meal out of it, so, and it's pretty good. Is it steak again?
Yeah,
sweet. All right, so, um, Sign-ups are out the door to my left, and there's also should be a set of sign-ups at the bottom of the stairs on the right. So if you can find one of those and get signed up for anything, just look through them, and if there's anything you can do, we'd appreciate the help. And there's a couple up front here for VBS, so make sure you get a hold of those as well. Oh, that's for American Legion right there? We'll put the American Legion ones out on the tables and get them where you can get them. All right? Yes, Sandy. There is. Okay, perfect. All right. No, so you have your own kid after church. They're not going to singing class, choir. And so you got your own kid, so make sure you got them, 5 through 8-year-olds. And then, of course, there is practice tonight at 6 for the next age group up. So be bringing them for that. All right? Love y'all. See you downstairs. If you want pancakes.